So I've been talking recently about how appellation hierarchies in Burgundy play out to the advantage of some and to the disadvantage of others. And I wanted to talk today about how those same appellation hierarchies operate within the context of the Côte d'Or. Now, if you taste in the cellars of Burgundy, you can easily come away with the impression that appellation is destiny. And as you start with the regional wines, you ascend to the communal appellations, then the Premier Cru, and then the Grand Cru, the wines gain in texture, structure, depth, dimension, potential complexity, and aging potential as well. And of course, this does reflect the reality that some sites are better for growing grapes than others. You know, our exposition, soil hydrology, and mesoclimate certainly mean that there are superior and inferior sites. But I want to argue today that this seemingly imminent hierarchy of appellations is in fact as much reinforced as it's being revealed when you taste through wines like that. Because in fact, rather than attempting to efface the differences between a superior site and an inferior one, they tend to be reinforced, beginning really with viticulture and often historically less likely to be fine quality selections of Pinot Noir and Chardonnay, more likely to be farmed for a high yield, less meticulously. Then come harvest time, if there's a rainstorm on the horizon or if the grapes are ripening too quickly, the priority is to pick the Grand Cru, and then the Premier Cru, then the village appellations. And then the same sense of priorities in the cellar, potentially less stringent sorting of the communal appellations, shorter macerations, likely less good oak barrels and fewer new ones, shorter élevage, and the wines bottled and brought to market faster. And all of these things conspire to mean that the village wines seldom have a real chance of rivaling their more celebrated neighbours. And in fact, if you think about it, the village sites are those where you could, in fact, ripen the smallest volume of grapes the most effectively, yet as an example of how this hierarchy is reinforced, it's there in the communal appellations where the maximum yield is at its highest, legally permitted. So, and to my mind, my perspective is that this really reflects a somewhat outdated economic imperative whereby, you know, making a living out of wine in Burgundy was much harder than it is today, and it's still not easy, absolutely. But when you see communal appellations retailing in the United States for over $100 a bottle quite routinely, you know, you begin to wonder whether the boundaries could be pushed a little bit more. And in fact, the great producers do push the boundaries, have been doing so longer, but I think we're going to see absolutely more of that, and people taking viticulture and winemaking for communal appellations much more seriously. Now, I buy a lot of village wines from producers I follow, and I'm very happy about that, and with the way they age. Just got a few out of my cellar to show for this video. Lafarge Volnay is from the 70s. I mean, magical bottle, still extremely youthful. A wine like this, Clos des Ombres from Arnaud-Aunt, really exemplifies what's possible when it comes from a Ludi in Merceau that's not even particularly propitious for viticulture. I mean, deep, rich soils, and yet it's a, sort of like a glitch in the matrix of the appellation hierarchy. You can really, if you have a bottle of the Clos des Ombres, and of course it's not inexpensive on the secondary market, but much better than the majority of Premier Cru White Burgundies that you find. If you taste 100 bottles, you're going to find very few that are superior to this. And I think, yeah, as I'd say, that's really a window into the future of Burgundy, where the higher prices of the wines, the incredible demand, is going to result in ever more serious communal appellations. So I think people who limit their purchasing just to the Grand and Premier Cru are really missing out in that respect.